Okay, well, good evening, everyone, and welcome to the regular meeting of the town board. We have public hearings, workshop, and our regular meeting. Today's Monday, September 12th. Please join me while we pledge allegiance to our flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Ken, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I would just like to make a motion on here to, if we can just switch the public comment real quickly, and we'll put the Eagle Scout first.
Absolutely.
So that way, we can get the Eagle Scouts up and going here. That'd be great. So I'll make a motion to do that, please.
And do we have a second? And all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. So before we do that, though, may I have a motion to accept the minutes of August 22nd?
So moved.
Second.
And second, and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so right now we have a Eagle Scout that we are acknowledging, and we'd like him to come on up, and our rec director, Kathleen Davis, to explain his project and all the good things he's done for Hyde Park.
Hey.
Hi, Kathleen.
Okay. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Right on up.
So we have Will Moss here with his scoutmaster, Jay Jaeger, from Troop 3037, the United Methodist Church of Hyde Park. And Will is a Eagle Scout candidate. He has his review next Monday. But he has completed a project, his Eagle project, at Hackett Hill Park. I'm going to hand out a couple photos for everybody.
Thanks.
So Will had come to me maybe about almost a year ago and was interested in doing a project associated with the Hyde Park Trail. So at the same time, the rec department was interested in putting in some more park benches at some of our parks, including Hackett Hill. And so we combined the idea, and Will built two cement and wood timber benches that he and his troop, you know, did all the work on, and they installed at Hackett along two of the trails. One of them was at overlooking the creek, the Crum Elbow Creek, on the Blue Trail at Hackett, which is behind the Paul Tegmeyer Memorial. And the other is on the Green Trail, which is cuts across the back of the property and is in a nice location as well. So Will, did you want to say anything about any of your work there?
Kathleen.
He had, it was hard. It was a real great project because we purchased molds. We figured, let's do this the most economical way we can do it. So if you look in a catalog at park benches, you know, commercial park benches can range between, I'm not kidding, like $500 to $700 each. And we wanted to originally purchase seven of them. So we did a little research, and we looked at different models, and we came up with a, sort of like a traditional heavy-duty type bench, which you see in the pictures. It's made with commercial plastic molds. You pour it. You have to mix the cement, let it set for a period of 10 to, well, we found out,
30.
More like 30 days, because they ended up making six of them when they only needed four. So the last set, they let set for like 30 days. So they didn't have any crumbling or splitting. So it was a real learning process, and they're beautiful. So Aileen, we wanted you to present, make the presentation.
Yeah, I would love to.
Okay, and I forgot my camera. So if Ken, could you take a couple pictures?
We're presenting this to Will Moss, Eagle Scout, to thank him and acknowledge the great work he did on our Hyde Park Trailblazer. So it's the Hyde Park Trailblazer Award in recognition of your outstanding service and for building benches to serve our community trails at Hackett Park. So here you go, Will. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Will. Nicely done. So the next item on our agenda will be the public comment on the Anderson Center Group Home. I just want to remind people of the ground rules here. When we have public comment, it's not a session for dialogue. What we do, it's a three-minute limit, but we will make the exception here. If your attorneys are here to present some information, we'll extend that. But other than that, please do limit your comments to 3 minutes, state your name, and we will have a discussion shortly after that amongst the board. Okay, so with that, may I have a motion to open the public comment?
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Please join us at the podium.
Thank you, Madam Supervisor. My name is Daniel Tuzinski, and I'm here representing a group of people who live in the vicinity of where the proposed group home is sited. We're going to basically go through a presentation where some of the people who helped put this together are going to make comments as we go along. I think it'll be consistent with your three-minute rule, except for me. And I'm like a facilitator. I'm going to provide you some information. We think the record is necessary to be built up here because we think that the applicant has missed a lot of issues, some of which deal with public safety, which we want to bring the board's attention. So at this point, I want to hand up a PowerPoint package for each board member and the town attorney. I'm also going to hand up a thumb drive, and it contains video, which you're going to see tonight, about the intersection of Connolly Road and Route 9G, just so that you have an idea of the issues that are associated with this location. So at this point, I'm going to hand these up and give each a copy, if that's okay.
Sure, of course.
And when you speak into the mic, not so close, please.
Okay. Actually, I'll give that to you.
Thank you.
We can share later. And we can share now.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll try to stay away from hogging the microphone here. So basically, I'm sure your town attorney has advised you as to the law dealing with these types of facilities and that they're governed by the mental hygiene law. And what we want to do is set the table for your options. I'm sure you do know the options, but we're going to be focusing on the second two options. We believe the town of Hyde Park should not approve this proposed site. We believe that the town of Hyde Park should invoke one of the two alternatives, either suggest a different location or deny it outright. These are your two options. Now, we're going to start with the last option first because we think there's compelling evidence why you should reject this application. And I'm going to walk through this with you, and we're going to have some of the people who've compiled the data address the board. Do you prefer they come up and use the podium?
Sure.
Might be easier?
We need to have this on video, and people won't be able to hear them otherwise.
Okay. We all know that the application is at 55 Connolly, and that's what the focus of our attention is tonight. We believe that the establishment of 55 Connolly Drive will result in an over-concentration of group homes. Now, we've taken the statute, and we think there's a misnomer. The analysis is not only in the proximity of the location. We think that whether there's an over-concentration in the town of Hyde Park, as related to other towns in Dutchess County, is highly relevant. So we've done an analysis from both perspectives.
Our video master has asked if you could just back off. Just
ooh, a, okay.
It's getting a lot
push
of.
Push it down a little bit.
Okay. Does this sound better?
Much better, thank you.
Is that okay, Herb?
Okay.
Good.
All right, good.
You.
Obviously, I have no ability to be a TV star, huh? I don't know how these microphones work. Okay. So, with regard to the overconcentration, this is what we found. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to have our statistician here, who basically compiled the data, address you a little bit on what we found, because the basis for our presentation is based upon certain facts that we found in the record. And as you'll recall, the applicant was required to furnish data from Dutchess County as to the number of group homes in each town within Dutchess County. So at this point, I'm going to turn this over to Doris Harrington on how she compiled information. But as of right now, we believe there are 11 group homes in Hyde Park. If we added this additional group home, this would make 12. So I'm going to turn it over to Doris Harrington.
Hi, Doris Harrington, 3 Connolly Drive in Statsburg. The Dutchess County Registry that was provided to the town provided to us, and that registry lists out by municipality all residential facilities, group homes, et cetera, et cetera. The analysis excludes the city of Poughkeepsie and the city of Beacon. It only includes the townships within Dutchess County. It also only includes those homes that would be comparable. In other words, IRAs, individual residential alternatives, that house between 4 and 14 residents. It does not include a large facility like the Anderson School itself. It does not include the Astor Home up in Rhinebeck, because those facilities house more people. It's very, very apples to apples comparison. And this, you know, this was the data that you were given that you then kindly forwarded to our group. And that is where we came up with those numbers.
Thanks.
So now, why is this important? Why is this important on an issue and analysis of overconcentration? Well, we've taken statistically and we've looked at the town of Hyde Park, and we looked at all of Dutchess County to determine if there's a disproportionate number of these facilities in Hyde Park. And we were surprised to find there is. So I'm going to go to the next slide. So this is what we have. We know there's 115 group homes in Dutchess County, at least as insofar as we're able to determine from the data provided by the applicant. We did find the data is a little bit difficult. There would seem to be some pages missing, but we've extrapolated what you as a board have to work on for our presentation. And what we found is Hyde Park, actually, in Dutchess County, comprises of 7.3% of the population. We also found that if you used a population-based analysis for how many group homes should be located in Hyde Park, we find that your pro rata share would be 8 group homes. Now, we know we have 11, and that this would be number 12. And currently, Hyde Park is 11, Connolly would be the 12th. So we did a population-based analysis. We did another analysis, and that's based on geographic area. So we know there's 115 group homes in Dutchess County. Hyde Park comprises 4.8% of the geographic area in Dutchess County. If we applied the pro rata analysis based on geographic area, you should have 6 homes. You, in fact, have 11 homes. This would be the 12th. So using both analyses, we have a disproportionate number of group homes in Hyde Park. And we also have, basically, if this is approved, we would have 70% more of our pro rata share based on an analysis. Now, the question that we said is, well, how could this be? How is it that there's so many homes in Hyde Park? And we did a little digging, and I can't credit myself because I kind of got into the game late on this and looking at the data, but we had a team who did an analysis, and we have a former supervisor, apparently a very good gentleman, a kindly gentleman, Pompey Delafield, I believe, who also happened to be a lifetime board member of the Anderson applicant. And so he was very friendly and very welcoming to these facilities, as well he should be. But we found that at least 4 group homes were relocated in Hyde Park during his tenure as a supervisor. Now, where does that leave us? Well, it leaves us with a disproportionate number of group homes in Hyde Park because of Supervisor Delafield's good work. But at this point, the question is it fair and is it appropriate to the town to locate another one in Hyde Park? What are the ramifications or the consequences? Well, we already know we're overweighted. What does that mean to the community? So we also did some digging to find out just how many properties are off your tax rolls, okay, based upon the not-for-profit group homes in our locale. And the data for this comes from the Dutchess County Parcel Tax Review mapping. And we sat down, we took an analysis, and right now, the town of Hyde Park has a loss of $2,509,000 in assessed value that are off the tax rolls. Okay, this equates to about $126,000 in total taxes a year. So we're talking about, well, why does this matter? Why do we say there's an over-concentration? Because there's a community-wide impact. And I want to be very clear The people that I'm here with tonight are 100% supportive of group homes. There's absolutely need for special needs. We have to have these facilities. The question, though, is what was the intention of the law? And we think the intention of the law is that it be balanced, that it be spread into different communities fairly, because it also gives the people who are living there an opportunity to be in different areas. We believe it brings a certain level of diversity, and then we believe that's what the intention of the statute is when you look at the Padovan Act as applied. But it has town-wide consequences, because right now, if we only had to shoulder our burden, our pro rata responsibility, okay, it would lose about $800,000 less in assessed value, and this itself would equate to $40,000 in savings and taxes. So there are consequences to taking a property off the tax rolls and adding it to an already diminished tax base. Now, Madam Supervisor, we've done our research, and we know what one of the determinations are of this board. The summer of 2016, you rightly indicated that the town board has a fiscal and financial responsibility. I am a former county attorney, and I've represented towns, and I will tell you there is mighty struggles with the tax cap. And how do we get more bang for our buck? And one of the things that we're saying is that as we try to balance our budgets and look at this, the revenues that are generated by real properties within the town of Hyde Park are absolutely completely relevant. So for the first reason, we believe that there is an overconcentration from a town-wide impact. We are shouldering a disproportionate burden from other municipalities. And the thing that disappoints us, and quite frankly, we're just doing an honest analysis with the Anderson application, is that we understand they signed a contract a couple months ago. Now, the statute allows them to come to the town first and to partner with this town or partner with other towns and try to determine the appropriate location. From what I can determine, that didn't happen. They picked a site, they went with it, and it does have consequences to the town on a community-wide basis. The other analysis we have is, what about the area? Okay, what about the area of Connolly Drive? Well, we know the following. We know that outside the entire area of Hyde Park, we currently have two homes within a half a mile radius of where this site is proposed, and two more homes just outside that radius. There is a hyper concentration in this particular area. And I'm going to turn this over to Ray Harrington, who helped compile the data, who lives on Connolly Drive. He knows the area, he knows where these are, and so at this point I want to turn it over to Ray.
Hi, would you mind going there just because the viewing public can hear you?
Evening, Madam Supervisor, Board, right? Welcome again. So what you're seeing, and I think you've seen some of this before, right? So after extracting the data that was provided to us and plotting, you know, the location of all these facilities in Hyde Park on a map, what we observed right away is that there was a disproportionate number of them in the northern part of the town, and in particular, right in our region after the new one was applied. And it just so happened, drawing a circle around the three nearest ones, or the two nearest ones, including the one proposed, within a 1 mile or a half mile radius, which equates to about 0.75 square miles, excuse me. Relative to the town of 39 square miles, we have 25% of the group homes in the town and 2% of the area. And this would be the densest region in the town, okay? It's a little difficult to see. I'll just point out where Connolly Drive is here.
You got the pointer, wait. I got a laser pointer, sorry about that. Actually, we have another.
And we're going to make sure that hard copies of what we submitted to the board or in this presentation are submitted to the board afterwards so that you can look at the data, you can look at the illustrations. You really can't appreciate it until you go here and you start plotting where these are. And I think that statistic is telling that there's a hyper concentration right in this area. So based upon the statutory provisions that you as a town board have to follow, and one of them is whether there's an over-concentration in the area, We think the evidence is compelling and overwhelming. If you look at the town of Hyde Park vis-a-vis other towns, we more than shoulder our burden. And when you look at Connolly Drive, there is already an over-concentration. This would add another parcel to this particular area. So let's talk a little bit about over-concentration, because another element that we have to establish is going to be a change in the nature and character of Connolly Drive. Now, at this point, I want to introduce Diane Chittenden. She lives on Connolly Drive. She has a career in real estate. She's familiar with value. She's familiar with the elements that are there. And what we've done is we thought, to illustrate the difference to the board, we wanted to tell you what is the existing nature, okay, and character of Connolly Drive. Because we're going to demonstrate later on, through additional analysis, locating this particular facility on this road will dramatically change the nature and character. Diane?
I don't know how to use this. Hi, thank you for allowing us to have our say here. I just wanted to talk a little bit about the fact that I'm one of the original residents in Connolly. And when I purchased, I was not yet in real estate, though Mr. Banatka and Mr. Andros sold that property to us based on these credentials. It's a park-like residential area, and when we first purchased, you could see that. You definitely could drive. There's curvy roads. Though they're curvy, it's unique and it's safe. We felt we all had small children. Then we then walked those properties and walked those roads and felt safe on those roads. And there was very limited traffic, and that too was sold to us. So with these characteristics, there is no sidewalks due to low traffic levels. There also were deed restrictions, restrictive covenants in place prohibiting commercial type uses. They were designed to prevent and preserve low traffic, meaning we were not allowed to put a business in our home. We were not allowed to run a business out of our home, because with that came clients, customers, in and out, more traffic on the road. The town and county zoning policies do not support further development or increased intensity of the use on Connolly Drive. So I think with these characteristics, my career in real estate came to be where I sold several homes and several pieces of vacant land within this development. And with that, my testimonial was true, because I was originally there as a resident. I brought clients, customers to this lovely park-like community, thinking that these roads were going to stay safe with low traffic. And I think our concern with this is that there will be an increase in traffic due to the business-like nature of the comings and goings of 55 Connolly Drive. Thank you.
Thank you.
I also want to bring to the board's attention that the other issue that is compelling evidence of what is the character and nature of Connolly Drive is that every residence on that road is subject to a declaration of restrictive covenants. Now, what does that mean? It means that when people bought into this community, knowing that the roadway that goes back through Connolly Drive doesn't have sidewalks, that it's a quiet, sleepy little area, they did so and they paid their consideration knowing that there's restrictive covenants involved. And we're going to hand up a section of the Declaration of Restrictions so that you can see this. Each parcel was intended to be single-family residential in nature. It was intended to have no businesses carried on within that area, and that no multiple dwellings may be erected on any lot. We think that's very relevant in terms of determining the intent. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about how the character will change if we expand the traffic on that road, and we're going to talk about that traffic in just a moment. Okay. So what's going to happen if there's over-concentration? What is going to happen generally? Well, we know the following things are going to take place. Number one, the traffic on Connolly Drive will increase substantially due to staffing, shift changes, needs of the group home. Number two, although the group homes are located in close proximity to 9G, there are none currently on Connolly Drive itself. And you're going to hear some testimony about the existing group home across the street, which one could easily argue is part of this community, generates a lot of traffic. There's a lot of congestion on Route 9G because of the people being transported back and forth, and it creates an effect on Connolly Drive in the mornings and the afternoons. You're also going to find that what's happened, and you're going to see some video about this, is that it is a very bad intersection. It creates a lot of delays getting in and out of it. And why is this relevant? Because we're going to tell you there are a lot more suitable sites that aren't going to exacerbate the problem. Additional traffic in this area is going to undermine the restrictive covenants. It's going to undermine the purpose by which people bought homes. And quite frankly, you wouldn't be able to put this development into the town of Hyde Park today, given the restrictions and the size of the cul-de-sac and the particular location, because we have one road in and one road out. So what I want to do at this point, and we have a couple people who can address the traffic specifically, who did a study, and I'll tell you what we did. We didn't just guess. We basically determined where the existing facility is, what kind of traffic demands there are, how many traffic trips are coming from that facility, and we've superimposed it on what would mean to Connolly Drive. So at this point, I'm going to call Paul Cantor up.
Do you have this on the...
Thank you.
Thank you.
If it's not up there, I'm sorry. I apologize to the audience, but the important folks have it. We, after our last meeting, which two of you board members were at, we met and we said, you know, maybe this thing isn't so bad, or are we overreacting, and what's the deal? And you might recall that I went up after and found the 8 to 10 cars up there, and I got upset about that. But then we just decided we needed a traffic to see, because Anderson kindly told us that the Enderkill property folks would be coming over, so we said, what's there? And if you turn to the first page, the second page, total traffic entering. So this we did by team members going for 20 of 24 hours. So maybe a little bigger than this, because we left around 11 o'clock at night and it'll come in the morning. But we found that, and this is at the Enderkill, that's September 6, 7, with nonstop for that 18-hour period. We found, amazingly to us, 21 trips entering and leaving Anderson. So these were cars that went up to Anderson or came down from Anderson. 21 at Anderson. We also found, by the way, if you go to, can you just give me the, if you go to the first picture, Enderkill has two, an entry, it's a loop, it has two. Anderson is located right at the corner, has no impact on anybody but one house across the street. So it's just a wonderful site as compared to ours. But in any case, there were 21 trips. We tracked every other car that went in and out, and there were, other than Anderson, in that 18-hour period, there were only 29 trips. So that was a total of 50 trips combining the two. And in that Enderkill slot, there were 42% of the traffic on that street was dedicated to Anderson. Now that has an in and out on both sides, so we couldn't really do a total study because we didn't have enough people to man both ends for 24 hours, and some of them went out. But clearly, the Anderson in is 100% of the Anderson, because no matter where they came from, we got them. So from we estimate there were a total number of 30 homes, if you go down the slide, on that Enderkill, including side streets. And if you take the 29 trips, it looks to us like there were 3 trips per day for a resident outside of Anderson, as compared to the 29 trips with Anderson. So we had this data. It's a little bit incomplete because of the in-out, but then we said, let's translate that to us, because these are the 5 folks that are going to move over. So if you go to the next page, you'll see we took that 3 cars per day, and we made a very conservative assumption, not very favorable to us. We said, let's double that. And let's say that every house has 6 cars going back and forth of non-Anderson. And that would be, if there's 46 homes on the street, that would be 276 trips a day. Anderson at 21, because they would be the same coming over, would be equivalent of 3.5 new houses on Connolly. However, as I understand, I'm not a lawyer, I understand that this approval, if you give it, gives Anderson the right to, down the road, increase up to 14 residents in that home. And if you just do a simple mathematical calculation, you find out that 14 residents would actually increase the equivalent to 8 to 10 homes on our Connolly Drive. And I finished, and I just have one final question for the board, and that's the last page. And as a homeowner, a resident, would you, the town board, or your planning board, or any unbiased board in the community or community of residents, ever approve any project that would increase the traffic in Connolly Drive from 4 to 10 homes when it's already totally illegal by current statute and it's only there as it is today because it was grandfathered in? To me, as a resident of the town and on the street, it just makes no logical sense. And we have all of the data and can give you all the supporting data, but going in wondering whether the Anderson numbers were accurate, it was just very, very eye-opening.
Thank you for that. I'm going to make a suggestion because, and hopefully the board will agree, we have another workshop planned for tonight, and Christine Borick has been waiting very patiently. Is it okay with the board if we interrupt right now, let Christine do her presentation because she's been sitting here for 45 minutes and I think it's going to be a lot longer. Does that make sense or no? Well, actually,
we don't have very much longer.
No?
We probably have 10 minutes.
Okay. All right. Okay.
I would think. Is that okay?
I'm sympathizing with her over there. So, okay. We'll continue then.
Thank you very much, Madam Supervisor. And you can see we had a little technology issue, but I think we solved it. So
okay, great.
Nothing like fictions. Okay. So what does this tell us based on my information? We respectfully say that the town should object, okay, to the siting of this group home at 55 due to the over-concentration that will substantially alter Connolly Drive neighborhood. You've seen the statistics. There's an over-concentration already. Now we're going to talk about siting other suitable locations. We're going to suggest one or more alternative suitable sites, and we have no evidence that the applicant made any attempt to find a better location. And you're going to find there's some serious traffic safety issues on this road coming out. We've put together the evidence, and we're going to basically lay in part of the record that Connolly Road is not a suitable site. Okay, the existing structure has limitations as compared to other sites. We're talking about the dwelling that they've selected. We found better alternatives, less expensive alternatives, better for the residents. And we're going to put that into the record so that you have that as a board. Route 9G intersection, if any of you members of Hyde Park Board who've ever gone in this area and gone up and down Connolly Road, you will know, just trying to pull out, it's a dangerous intersection, it's congested. We have an engineer who's going to talk to you about this site cries out for a traffic study. We've known since 1997 there's been an issue there. It's still an issue, and you're going to see some video footage that's going to show that for you. Connolly Drive has no emergency access alternative. So if there's an accident at the entrance of 9G and Connolly Drive, how does anybody get past? What if the residents, special needs people, need any type of assistance? You can't get through that intersection. That's a limiting factor. Connolly Drive limits the group home's residences and their quality of life. I understand that the applicant has said they have two visually impaired individuals. They're not going to walk on the streets. I will tell you right now that we have people who have experience with people with special needs. To say that they can't walk on the street because there's no sidewalks is a detriment, and it's a limitation. What else do we know about the 9G intersection besides Connolly Drive? We have a heavy traffic volume. We have people who frequently exceed the speed limit. There is no signal to manage the intersection. It's a four-way intersection. 9G, traffic is not required to stop. We have residents who live on that road. They will tell you that there's regular driver confusion with people pulling up, motioning each other on. And we're talking about being a vehicle transporting people with special needs to another facility. There's also an ingress-egress problem that creates a bottleneck. I'm going to talk to Steve, ask Steve Ackerman now to maybe come up and talk a little bit about some of the information he's accumulated. And then we're going to have our engineer talk a little bit about this particular location.
Evening, Steve Ackerman from 21 Connolly Drive. So we took a look at one of the existing Anderson homes, the one on Enderkill Drive, and that's been mentioned tonight. Diane Crittenden, our realtor who lives on our street, has done a lot of work looking for alternative sites that Anderson, that we'd like to propose that Anderson consider. And so I'll compare the one Anderson location at Enderkill, four sites that we're proposing Anderson should seriously consider as alternatives, and then compare those and the character of those to the 55 Connolly Drive location that Anderson is currently proposing. So first, 24 Enderkill Drive is an Anderson facility. And it's, I don't know if it's that visible, but it's kind of a loop that connects to Route 9 on both ends.
Yeah, thanks.
So it's a loop that connects on both ends. And one of the things that Anderson says is we've had hardly any complaints on this from our facility on the street. But when we did the traffic study, we realized why. Their group home is one driveway away from Route 9. It's probably 100 feet or a couple hundred feet. And all the vehicles went in and out, you know, in that short distance. So everyone else on that street never sees an Anderson vehicle coming by their home. Okay. Oh, before you go on. So I illustrate it. You go back. It's a quiet street, and even with the Anderson facility, it's still a quiet street because none of the traffic goes by homes on the rest of the street.
One home.
There's one home across the street. That's right. And then, of course, there's dual ingress and egress, unlike Connolly Drive. And these intersections, as far as we know, are not nearly as dangerous as the intersection on Connolly. They're just T-intersections. Ray? Yeah, they're T-intersections. Okay. Moving on, the technology's not, okay. The first proposed site is at 107, I believe, Haviland Road. It's a house for sale.
109.
And one of the dramatic differences in character between this road and Connolly and Enderkill is it's basically a busy through road. I'm sure most of you know about Haviland. There's a lot of traffic going back and forth, a lot of side streets. So it's a very busy through road, so very different character than either Enderkill or Connolly Drive, which are very quiet streets. So given that it's a busy through road, let's say there's 500 or 600 or 1,000 trips per day of traffic, 20 trips per day, adding in, you know, an Anderson facility of 20 is going to have no impact to that area. There's good ingress and egress. There, Haviland connects out on this end to another street, Quaker perhaps, and then on the other end, of course, to Route 9, or 9G rather, and there's a traffic light. Okay. The second proposed alternative, and probably are what we think is maybe the best for Anderson, is at 35 Pine Woods. And Diane can talk a little bit about the character of the homes. I'm just talking more about the character of the street and the traffic aspects. Again, Pine Woods Roads is a very busy through road. good ingress and egress, both ends. If one is blocked, you know, emergency vehicles can get in the other. There's a traffic light on the Route 9 end. And again, because it's such a busy road, we don't think that adding a group home here would dramatically alter the character of this neighborhood. Third is at 54 Beadart Place. Different neighborhood, very quiet. But again, the location of the home is very close to the entrance to the street. So I think only four homes would be passed if a group home was put in here. And a lot of ingress and egress, of course, and out to Route 9. There's a lot of different ways that emergency vehicles could go in and out. Okay. And finally, South Quaker Lane. Again, very busy through road, as you all know. Good ingress and egress. There's traffic lights at both ends. And again, because it's such a busy road, we don't think that adding a group home at this location would dramatically alter the character of the area. So then finally, 55 Connolly. You see there's Route 9 here with a very dangerous intersection, which I think you'll hear more about in a second. 9G, sorry. An existing group home already, just south of our intersection. The proposed location at 55 Connolly, which is way at the end of our street. So every time that a Anderson employee drives in or out of the street, it's not going to be like Enderkill, where it's just passing one home that sees the traffic. It's going to be passing either 29 homes if they take this route or 27 homes if they take this route. So really drastic alteration to the character of our neighborhood. And then, of course, added to that is the dangers of the intersection and the fact that a group home is right nearby. And you'll see there's aspects of this group home location that are affecting Connolly residents as we go in and out of the neighborhood.
Yeah. Thank you.
We're almost finished. I know you're getting impatient, and we've listened to a lot of our data. I just wanted to show
very, very thorough and very impressive.
We just wanted to show a couple videos because it's hard to bring you to Connolly Drive at the intersection. So we have a couple discrete videos that were taken just on 2 days. And we have a number of residents who live on Connolly Drive who will tell you what it's like to come in and out of this intersection every single day. But they say a picture's worth 1,000 words, a movie's worth 10,000 words, because we've taken two short snippets just to give you an indication of how long people wait, what the traffic pattern is, and just up the street is another group home which has a bus which stops and lets people in and out and causes the traffic to bottleneck. So I'm going to turn it over to Ray Harrington. He and his wife took a couple of short videos just to give you an idea of what's going on at this intersection.
Right. Excuse me. So you've heard me talk previously about this intersection and how treacherous it is. So let me just give you a sort of lay of the land here. So our home is 3 Connolly Drive right here, okay? And these videos you're going to see are taken right from our home, from our property right on the corner here. And we're facing south. One of them, I believe, is in the afternoon and one in the morning, or they might both be in the afternoon. They were just 2 days, last Thursday and Friday, I believe it was. I think my wife did one and I might have took the other. Okay, and you can't hear sound here, but actually pause the video 1 second. So what's going to happen here? The traffic backs up, which happens, you know, quite a bit at times. And the traffic gets very heavy in the morning during the morning commute and in the afternoon commute. This, I think, took place at 4 in the afternoon, roughly. And you're going to see one of our residents, a young man here, trying to navigate the intersection as the traffic, you know, gets bottled up. Okay. And you don't have sound, but... Okay. So he winds up sitting here for quite some time, and eventually he'll get impatient. There's another school bus. You can see some of the traffic is moving at a pretty good clip. School bus turns, the traffic is backed up heavily. Fortunately right now, this line of traffic that's backed up is moving relatively slowly. Very often you'll get traffic coming from the north that's doing 60 miles per hour. Okay, the traffic's picking up speed, he's still trying to get out. You can't, if it was magnified, you see, you may notice he's looking both ways here. In a minute he starts to lean forward, he's trying to see what happens. He finally starts to see an opening. We've all done this. And he starts to look, he says, okay, I think it's clear. He's leaning forward, and he goes. Now another car is bearing down on the left. Right there, he chirps his tires. You don't hear it, but he guns it. All of us have done that as well, right? Because the traffic, you can't see very well past the pole. There's a turn down here. There's another turn to the north on 9G. And you can see traffic starting to pick up here. Morning and night when I drive this, if I come at my intersection at 55 miles an hour, people are following me at 55 miles an hour. If I did 60, they'd probably follow me at 60. Okay, thank you. Okay.
There's two of them that I think you need to see. They're illustrative, two different times, of the traffic patterns and the difficulty. What you don't see here, members of the board, is just down the road to the right is the other group home facility.
Right, so the Greystone Statsburg house is just about right here behind this tree line. And very often when the bus drops them off, you know, traffic will tend to back up at those times. It backs up at other times from other events. So this, I think, was taken the previous day, and traffic's coming from the south again. And I think what you'll see here is, a big traffic, line of traffic. You'll see some sort of chaotic stuff going on. People will start to pass off to the right because there's no turn lanes here at all, anywhere. So when traffic stops to make a left turn, people will tend to go around them. You can see there's a lot of traffic in the afternoons. There is in the morning as well. One car turns in. You can see there's not a lot of traffic turning onto our road. Car stops to turn here. You're going to see somebody else gun around him at a pretty good clip. I've seen this a few times, and I can't help but flinch when I see this. Let me just tell you. This goes on routinely, okay?
That's how my husband got hit, and that's how my son got hit. Exactly that thing right there.
Yeah, okay. And there's still traffic coming. Yeah. The only good thing about when the traffic backs up, it does tend to slow down a little bit. And very often, when it's not that backed up, they're just flying. Okay. Let me make a couple of quick comments, which I might have made previously, but I've mentioned before, this is a cross intersection. And Route 9G, as you all know, is, you know, basically one of the north-south corridors through Hyde Park. Route 9 is the other. The major crossway between 9 and 9G, north of the town center, is Route 37. That's also a 55-mile-an-hour limit. It's relatively straight. People also do 60 and 65 through that at times. Because it's so straight and fairly wide and paved, you get a lot of traffic through there, all the traffic from the north. People that need to work over on the east side of town go through there or need to get over the Taconic. This is a cross intersection. Current Dutchess County Code says cross intersections shall be avoided, except at major roadway intersections. Well, our little sleepy Connolly Drive is not a major road intersection. So this intersection wouldn't even be allowed nowadays, right? Nothing would. And previously somebody alluded to the dangers of the ingress and egress for cul-de-sacs, right? And I may have mentioned previously, current town of Hyde Park zoning also says cul-de-sacs shall be minimized, okay? Dutchess County zoning says cul-de-sacs shall be limited to 800 feet. We're 3,750 feet to the back from there to there, so 3/4 mile. Current cul-de-sacs by Dutchess County guidelines, zoning code, should be limited to 10 homes. We have 46, I think, here, okay?
Two lots
left to populate that have sat for quite a while. And most of those guidelines are all predicated on traffic considerations, ingress, egress, smooth flow of traffic, and particularly access of emergency vehicles. And again, the high speed and dangerous nature of this intersection, many of our residents will tell you there's been very serious accidents here. People have pulled kids out of cars from this intersection. One of our neighbors early on was badly injured at this intersection. So this is not some sort of statistical possibility or remotely possible event. Access to our road has been blocked off many, many times in the past. Okay. Thank you.
Hello there. So I'm Lynn Schiffer from 30 Connolly Drive, and I've been at 30 Connolly Drive for 25 years. So we've heard about the dangers of that intersection. I love my street. I love my neighborhood. I love my neighbors. With one major exception, I don't love that intersection. That intersection is awful. In 1991, when we found the perfect location for our dream home, I have to admit, we were pretty naive. We did not realize that this one way in and out of the street was going to have an impact, and it absolutely has. Most of us have either witnessed or been involved in way too many close calls at this intersection. There's some accidents that are just an inconvenience. There's those that really personally have an impact. Unfortunately, I've been one that was a personal impact. Wasn't me who was in the accident. It was May or June of 2008. I remember in absolute detail this accident. It was first thing in the morning. I was bringing my kids to school. I was attempting to get off of Route 9 of Connolly Drive to get onto 9G. I was got to the end of the street, and very clearly I drove up immediately after an accident had taken place. I couldn't get off Connolly Drive. My kids were going, "We're going to be late for school. Sit down. Let's see what's going on." Next thing I saw was a young woman come stumbling out of a very, very badly damaged car, crying hysterically and stumbling. She was clearly very shaken, and I quickly realized she was somebody I knew. She was one of my daughter's friends. I jumped out of my car. I ran over to help her. I sat her down on the curb in front of my neighbors, the Crittenden's house, and she was sobbing that all she was doing was driving from the north to the south on Route 9G. She was on her way to school. A car had come from Route 37, the county route across from us, had not stopped at a stop sign, and just kept going. Came right into her. The entire passenger side of her car was completely smashed in. Thank goodness she had no passengers that day. I don't even want to think of what would happen to any passenger that had been in the car. Well, the one that hit her was actually a van that I'm positive was either Greystone or Cornerstone on it. I don't remember exactly, but it was a van filled with disabled adults who were very, very confused. And I remember that the driver, in amid all the chaos that was going on, was really struggling to keep them in their seats. Anyway, back to helping my daughter's friend. We called 911. We called her parents. She went by ambulance to the hospital. I know she missed multiple days of school. I know she went through many months of physical therapy in order to take care of her neck and her back that were injured. I know that my children missed the morning of school that day. We could not get out of Connolly Drive. There were ambulances, there were fire trucks, there was four different directions of cars that were backed up. Anybody who was attempting to go to work that morning could not get to work. Anyone who was attempting to go to school could not get to school. If there had been any emergency anywhere in those 46 houses on Connolly Drive, I don't know how any emergency equipment could have gotten to anybody. The street was completely backed up. This happened to have been just at the very end of the school year. It was just a couple weeks later that, for those who had kids at FDR High School, you know that right before the prom, they do a mock accident session. Well, this young woman volunteered to play the accident victim just a couple weeks later, and I remember talking to her that she said it really hit her so hard to realize how close she had come to being, you know, a true statistic that day when she had her accident. So I'll just finish by saying that at least once a year during the school years, you know, all the years that my kids have been in school in Hyde Park School District, there have been accidents like this where they could not get to school on time, or they could not get home on time, or I could not get to work. I've written way too many notes to the schools explaining that my kids were late because of an accident at the end of our street. There have been some improvements that have been made at the end of our street over the years, but unfortunately that single in and out I know cannot be improved, and I personally think that it should be really a major consideration by Anderson or any other group to put a group home on Connolly Drive.
Thank you.
Hi, this is very short. Rachel Crittenden, 2 Connolly Drive. It was our property that Lynn was talking about. We're on the other side across from Ray and Doris. And I'm 25 years old. We purchased, they purchased when I was in 1992 when I was 1 year old. So I grew up hearing about this intersection and how terrible it was. Literally hearing it waking up in the middle of the night because cars had smashed into the telephone pole or raked down. We used to have a big sign called, it said North Crosslands. Raked it down once. My dad built it back up, raked it down again. We had a stone wall out there, also twice. Was raked down once, my dad built it back up, was raked down again. Neither of those exist anymore because there's no point to putting them back up. And besides that, two specific anecdotes. One is about 10 years ago, we were barbecuing out on our deck, which you can very clearly, you know, through the trees, but see the Route 9G. And we heard a crash, which was very, you know, it's always surprising because it's so loud and terrifying, but it's it wasn't that surprising because we'd heard them many times before. My dad, as usual, would sprint out and go help because we could be the first people on the scene. And in that particular crash, he was handed a baby from the back seat of the car, that like a mangled car. So that's one thing I remember. Like I said, it was about 10 years ago. And I've had people come up when I'm home alone, like banging on the door, needing help because there was a crash that happened at the end of the intersection. This is when I was young. And so I just do want to reiterate that. And Ray has also spoken to hearing things in the middle of the night. And it's just something that I've always known. When I was first learning to drive, that was kind of the header about, you know, getting out into intersections. It was always that intersection that you really had to pay attention to. So thank you
Rachel. We've provided this information about this intersection. It would be imprudent if we didn't tie it together with an engineer who can tell you the significance of the data that we provided you. And remember, you don't have to say no, you can't locate in Hyde Park, although we do think it's over-concentrated. You have the power to say, I'm sorry, folks, this isn't the location. And I think when you hear the engineer, this is important information to consider. Mark Millspaugh is with a Sterling engineering firm. He's done a great deal of zoning, land use. He's done work for towns. He's familiar with intersections. He's familiar with roadways. He's going to give you a little additional information.
Thank you. As Dan said, I'm Mark Millspaugh with Sterling Environmental. I was asked to give kind of a independent review of the existing traffic documentation. The records that this board's been provided with in the past and have been submitted to New York State DOT include the 1997 study that the citizens of Connolly Drive put together, the residents, I should say. And that documentation, while not compiled by a traffic engineering firm, is pretty good information. It speaks to the existing condition at that time. So 1997, development of Connolly Drive, the number of houses that were there at that time, and the traffic patterns that existed on Route 9G at the time. So that's 25 years ago, 24 years ago. You fast forward to 2016, and the level of use on 9G is different. The traffic patterns in the town are different. The dynamics of that intersection are different. And outside looking in, since I'm not a resident of the town or of Connolly, just outside kind of looking at the facts, the situation calls out for an updated traffic study by a traffic engineer. If this was any other kind of project and not a group home enjoying some of the exemptions that they get on site plan review and consistency with zoning and that sort of thing. Any other kind of project, even the existing development that's out there, would a planning board, I would expect your planning board, would require a traffic study. The reason modern codes, like the town and Dutchess County, the reason they impose limits on dead-end streets and cul-de-sac streets is because of the overall safety and the ability to ingress and egress during emergencies. You heard comments tonight that this is well over 800 feet and well over 10 homes. So adding the equivalent of 4 or up to 8 additional homes to the traffic is a situation that would not be permittable under current codes. And I understand that, you know, this project doesn't have to go through that type of review, but if it did, it would require a traffic study in order to complete SEAKER. I suspect that the lack of sidewalks is another significant issue in the use of the neighborhood by its residents, and if the group home was added. I took a drive around the neighborhood this evening, And not only are there no sidewalks, but the vegetation on either side at many locations is out to the edge of pavement. So you can't even walk off the pavement in some areas if you wanted to. Add to that, I didn't see any signs that prohibit on-street parking. I don't know if that's been a problem, but that's certainly a consideration as well. Because if there's a car parked on the street or partially off the street, the width of the road is not wide enough to accommodate two-way traffic. I won't repeat a lot of the comments that have already been made made tonight in the interest of time, except to say that while this isn't going through formal site plan review, and I don't believe it triggers SEAKER in any substantive way, it does call out for an updated traffic study. Thank you.
One of the things we wanted to do is provide this board with options. And a few minutes ago, Steve got up and talked to you about some alternative sites. There's not a limit on the number of available homes and places to locate a facility that is safer and more in keeping with the community character. Diane Chittenden has done an analysis. I believe you've received it, showing 20 homes that she did in a fairly short order. Do you want to address any of that at this point? Okay, she wants to mention one home which we think is a better home, and just for purposes of the record, because you have a determination, you can say it's there's too many, it's oversaturated. You can also say there's a better site, and that's what we want to do, is empower this board to make a good decision for the town of Hyde Park and also the residents of this group home going forward. Diane?
Thanks. Okay, so quickly, thank you for allowing this time. I feel that Pine Woods Road, after studying all of these, I did present 15, I believe, to Supervisor Rohr, but I believe that with Pine Woods Road is one level living. This home is looking, because of the sight impaired gentleman, for this one level living aspect. This home is secluded, it's back, and I know that they've also mentioned they like the seclusion. It's great for them to enjoy, you know, and relax. So this has four bedrooms that exist already, and they also have four full baths that exist on that same level. You enter only one step up. All they'd have to do is put one slight ramp. Also, my gosh, I took Ray and Doris because they've been through the studies. They have a child who was in a group home as an adolescent and also as an adult, so I felt that they would be good candidates to bring as far as what their opinion would be if they were looking for a site for their child to exist in. So with this, they also have these huge rooms that can be divided up. If they need be, they can put at least four more bedrooms on that one level. They also have a large kitchen with an eat-in area. They have a full dining room. They have a huge recreation area. All, again, on one level. And then if you do go down, there's a daylight basement. With that daylight basement, they've partially finished. I think that what the previous owner's intent may have been was to do a bed and breakfast there, because they have rooms down there that can be, there's already a bathroom plumbed in. There are at least, I think,
three.
Yeah, three more rooms that have been framed down there. So, and with ingress, egress, there's, you know, again, it's a daylight basement with a full sliding door out to a deck with a hot tub. And there's also a pond on this property. And from what I understand, these gentlemen enjoy their trout fishing, enjoy fishing as a whole. I just feel that if I was looking as a realtor for the need and taking into my client's consideration of what they really need, I feel that this home would be a perfect home for them, as perfect as you could be, as opposed to Connolly Drive, would they would have to adapt that home to the need. And this already has, I believe it's, I put the glasses on, 8.38 acres. So Connolly, I think, is about four acres. So it does provide seclusion. It also provides, there's an ingress of a driveway that loops around and comes back out onto Pine Woods. So they have a safe way that they could create a one way in and one way out, which again, for safety vehicles. So that's my professional opinion for whatever it's worth, but I would like to say that that's the best. And we did find a few others, but they can be adapted, but I feel that this one's the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to thank everybody for their time and patience, but we felt it's very important to bring this information to you. I want to jump to the conclusion at this point, and we'll go to the next slide because these are the circumstances. We believe, quite frankly, you should object to the siting of 55 Connolly, the proposed group home on Connolly Drive, but we also think that given all the information, this board has to seriously consider giving other potential locations, because we're talking about the interests of the community. We're also talking about the safety of the residents of the group home being located on Connolly Drive, as well as their needs. And I understand there's a bill pending in the legislature to try to get group homes to partner with towns to find the best possible locations. I would ask the people from Anderson to consider withdrawing its request that this town act within 40 days. Partner with us. Partner with the town. Let's find the best possible facility that maximizes safety for the residents of the proposed group home as well as the community. I believe, members of the board, you have that power. It's given to you by statute. I ask you to exercise that power. Let's make the right decision. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone, for your very sage comments and your input. Please do bear with us. We have a guest.
Could I just, I don't know if there was anyone else who
wanted
to speak on this.
Yes, there may be. Yes, it looks like there is.
Oh, okay.
Very quick. I'll try to 3 minutes. I'm basically here, Jeanette Martino, as a taxpayer, not as a resident on Connolly Drive. And yes, I think there's a concentration because the base of operation is the campus. So as their transportation needs and their maintenance needs, they concentrate in that area. But there is one thing that really bothered me when I had a chance to view the August 18th, and that was the statement that was made, it falls within the dollar amount per resident as the criteria for the purchase of the property. And I think that basically is very worrying to me because there is a diminishing tax base. Since 2009, Hyde Park, we've lost over $1 million in taxable property. And after watching that presentation, with the lost money in the the tax exempts, I mean, that's a big chunk. And I know that there are a lot of factors for a diminishing, tax base. But one of them, I think the most important one, is the market approach that we use to assign property values. And that, I think, is where the tax certiorarys that we've seen happening, the fact that we started with them at the beginning of the year and resolutions have continued, that is an indication of what is happening in that market trend. And I think that is also a good indication of what is happening with the market values, decreasing, and basically that's causing, a greater diminishing tax base that you have to now deal with, in trying to, deal with in the tax levies. And what that means is that there are negative factors. Number one, we have lower property values, but our taxes are going up. Not good. I noticed that this year our tax base diminished, but the other surrounding municipalities did not. We're in competition with them. We're trying to attract developers commercially and with residential development. How can we compete when we have these negative factors? Number one, banks do not like to, they're very cautious. They demand more money up front when you are buying in an area that has a trend. And remember, we go back to 2009 of a diminishing tax base because they don't want their mortgages to go underwater as that property possibly loses more value. We have buyers that, might not want to buy at the market value. What are they waiting for? They're waiting for that property to devalue. They're waiting for a good bargain. They want to buffer any negative equity in the property that they just purchased. And I think that speaks to what's happening with the purchase at Connolly Drive. It was a good buy. But what's gonna happen is that if we continue with this trend, we're gonna be opening up the door to more such purchases. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so would anyone else from the public like to come on up and speak?
Yes, my name is Paul Streitman. My name is Paul Streitman. I live at 35 Connolly Drive. And I just want to remind the board that you're about to resolve on local law K to increase our taxes beyond the state tax cap. And you just heard how this is a problem financially for the town to approve this group home. Well, how can you increase taxes and allow things like this? Thank you.
Thank you for your comment. Would anyone else like to speak?
Madam Supervisor, I'm just going to give you a copy of the unexecuted declaration of restrictions. We had it from the title work. I don't see it. I'll scan it and send it tomorrow, but I just want to put it into the record, if I may. This has been executed, and the lots that are in this location are subject to these restrictions.
Okay. Thank you.
I would just like to say how much I've enjoyed living. I'm Barbara Streitman from 35 Connolly Drive. And I've enjoyed living on Connolly Drive because I can walk, I can ride my bicycle, I can meet my friends in the neighborhood and walk. There are many of us who are out there on bicycles and walking, including a family, a newer family with a one-year-old and a three-year-old who are out there with a stroller, and senior citizens like myself. And there are two new families with small children at 59 and across the street from me, I'm not sure what the number is. So I've enjoyed the neighborhood. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Sure, come on up.
Peter Worsnick, 85 Connolly Drive. I'm a retired firefighter from Fairview. You're well aware of the tax difficulties that Fairview is having. Hyde Park is heading down that same road. I have the misfortune of arriving at the scene of an auto accident many years ago, which started the traffic study on Connolly Drive and Route 9G. It was an accident early morning hours, 8 a.m., a lot of traffic. And it was a T-bone accident, which means one car hit the other car broadside. In that car were two young people. One was very seriously injured, unconscious, laying on the lap of the other child. They needed to be extricated, and I assisted the tow truck operators at the scene trying to get at that patient, at both patients, and trying to administer as much first aid as I could, doing both, awaiting the arrival of Statsburg and their ambulance. I also would like to add that those two children were mine. Since then, or following that accident, there was a big protest, culminated or a combined effort between the town board and the residents of Connolly Drive. Supervisor Tom Spence was there and participated in one of those. The traffic study that was compiled after that, although it is very dated, called for things like removing the speed, removing the passing zone through the intersection, moving the telephone pole from the road side of the curb to the grass side of the curb. Obvious things that were missed prior. It has been almost 20 years. It is time for another traffic study, at the very least. I still warn visitors to be careful when they leave my home at that intersection, just to be careful. Go right, go left. Take your time. My children have since left the area. to find better jobs in other towns, which have stores that they can buy jeans and sneakers in, because those towns have tax base. About 5 years ago, I got called to that intersection again. This time, it was my wife was involved in that accident. I'm wondering when my turn is. When is my time up? When is it going to happen to me? I thank you for your time, and I want you all to consider the implications of putting a group home at 55 Connolly Drive and how it affects all the residents of Hyde Park.
Well, thank you. Okay, and yeah, please.
Scott Tuttle, 25 Connolly. I just wanted to add my voice to the many that we've heard about that intersection. I want to just add something a little different about it, some different characteristics of it. I think that Ray did a fine job showing the video of that. One thing that you didn't see, though, is what it looks like when you're coming to that intersection, what you see to the right. What you see to the right is a curve, and the cars are going to be coming around that curve at 55 miles an hour or greater. And there's very little distance between when the car becomes visible and when you can pull out. So what you're doing is you're looking both ways, and you see finally that you have a clear spot. You do not see any cars coming around that curve. And as soon as you start to go out into the road, all of a sudden, here comes a car whizzing. Coming, and they come and they bear down on you. Some of them are very nice, they'll slow down. Some of them are on the verge of road rage, where they come up right behind you and let you know that you pulled out. And it's not really your fault, because you didn't see any car at that time. And I think that from the perspective of the cars coming around the curve, they think that you pulled out in front of them on purpose. We had one incident where we came out to that intersection, saw that it was clear. We pulled out. All of a sudden, a car came around the curve, and they came and they tailgated us all the way. When we got to the Poughkeepsie Police Station, where it used to be, we pulled in. I mean, this guy was right on our tail. And I think that there was a potential there that we could have, you know, I mean, you hear about road rage all the time, and it seems to be getting worse, where people are actually, you know, shooting each other. We were actually very scared about that. And I think that the point I'm trying to make is aside from the fact that there's been accidents there, I think there's a large potential for additional road rage incidents like the one that we experience. And it's not a very comfortable thing. So I just wanted to add my voice to that aspect of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Sure. Hi.
Good evening. Good evening, Madam Councilwoman and Council. I'm Dave Coots. I've come in a little late, so I don't know exactly what might have been shared about deed restrictions, but I would like to share my experience both with the town and with the deed restrictions. I live at 75 Connolly Drive. We bought the property when it was owned, already had been bought from the development and owned by somebody else, for whatever reason, chose not to build on the property. So it went for sale. My wife, Jane, and I purchased it. When we began to think about look at the situation of the house on the property, we brought a friend who was a surveyor who lives in Hyde Park, walked the property with us, looked at the layout of the house and said, this house really should be moved further back. And by the way, when you do that, you won't have to stick the house up so far and add in so much fill to get to where the septic was, where the leach field was. So work was done to move the house back a little bit, change the orientation, and plans were drawn up. I was not able to act on those plans until the town of Hyde Park allowed that. The town of Hyde Park was not allowed to act on to approve that until they got the okay from the engineer who was in charge of the development. Needless to say, I had a very difficult time with the development engineer. I wasn't allowed to have appointments. And I only share this in that the deed restrictions for me were a very personal and challenge to get our house built. It ended up that our house does not overlook a septic. It overlooks a beautiful area the way it was moved. the garage originally on the faced out, the doors faced out to the road, which was deemed to be unacceptable by the development engineer, so that got shifted around. I had to live through those changes and the expense of it, so you could say perhaps I didn't understand the restrictions of the deed, but I still had to deal with all of that to be allowed to build a house in this development. My challenge of doing that says, okay, these are the standards of the development. This is what we bought into, this is where we live. It's difficult to think that what we are all held accountable to and what the town of Hyde Park held me accountable for, because until that engineer approved it, I could not get Don Westermeyer's agreement to get a building permit and to proceed forward on the construction. What was done to me as someone who loves the property I live on, it's hard to accept that what was the standard for us and the town held me accountable for is no longer held accountable. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to come on up? Okay. I'm going to ask for a motion to close the public comment.
So moved.
And a second.
Second.
And I appreciate all the very cogent statements that you all made. We are going to have a short presentation because we've invited a guest, and I'm sorry about the timing. And let her do a presentation on something wonderful she's doing for our community. And Christine Borick, would you mind coming on up to the... Yes, please, yeah. Oh, sorry. So vote on closing the public comment. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so just bear with us. I'm eager for Christine to tell us about the very good work she's doing in the town of Hyde Park and many places in Dutchess. So thank you for coming, Christine.
Oh, no, and thank you. And thank you for having me. And actually, I am a resident of Hyde Park. So this was interesting information, and thank you for all of our concerned citizens. I am the executive director of Rebuilding Together Dutchess County. My name is Christina Borick. And thank you, board, for having me here again to talk about our nonprofit organization and the work that we do here in Dutchess County. And I'm so happy that there's so many people here to listen, and thank you for recording, and hopefully those at home will act upon this as well. Rebuilding Together, Dutchess County believes that every person deserves to live in a safe and healthy home. We are a community revitalization organization that provides critical home repairs, accessibility modifications, and energy efficiency upgrades to Dutchess County homeowners at no cost to them. And we have a previous board member in the room, actually. Thank you, Anne, for your service to our organization. Individuals that qualify for our services is mostly based on income. Certainly that information can be found on our website, rtduchess.org. And you may be surprised to find who would qualify. So I do encourage you that if you know somebody who could benefit from our services, oftentimes it's individuals that are deferring maintenance to their home because they are physically unable to do the work and most certainly do not have the resources to do that. Or they are disabled or elderly and need modifications to their home in order to live safely and remain in place, remain in the communities. And you can all are very passionate about your community. So you can understand individuals wanting to stay in their home, live with amongst the people that they have raised their children with, live in the home that they have all of their memories in. And the work that we do allows people to stay in the homes that they want to stay in. As I mentioned, we are a nonprofit organization. We've been here in Dutchess County. Next year will be our 25th year. In that time, we've completed over 460 projects here in Dutchess County, engaging over 12,000 volunteers. The majority of the work that we accomplish is with volunteers. And to give you a sense of the impact that has on our community, we've invested about $5 million of market value of repairs into homes when you take into consideration the value of our volunteers' time, in-kind services and materials, and then the materials that we certainly purchase through donations and fundraisers and grants that we have available to us. We are part of an affiliate network that spans the entire country. There are 166 affiliates throughout the country, so certainly if you have family members or friends in other parts of the country, please do encourage them to research whether or not there is a rebuilding together in their community. But what that means is that we are 166 affiliates strong. We certainly learn from each other and utilize information that allows us to serve our homeowners best. The work that we do stabilizes neighborhoods. We are all very concerned about affordable housing, and I believe, and there are a number of studies that show that owner-occupied residents certainly do care for their homes, care for their communities, and so it's very important that not only do we maintain affordable housing for individuals who are looking to come into our neighborhoods, that there is something for them to afford and come into, but certainly also to have a nice diversity and make sure that we have owner-occupied residents that are oftentimes the foothold in our neighborhoods, as you all are in yours, I'm sure. So the homeowners we serve oftentimes stay in their homes. Those homes stay as owner-occupied homes. And a very important component of that is that they remain to pay taxes within our community. And we find that the majority do stay and remain owner-occupied. And if you think about that deferred maintenance I talked about before, we also stabilize value. So if a home gets to a point where somebody can no longer maintain it and they need to leave that home, vacate that home, we know that statistics say that a home that becomes unoccupied in a neighborhood has a tremendous impact on the value. We have a real estate agent in the room who certainly could agree with us on that. I believe the statistic is for every vacant home, the property value in that neighborhood will decrease by 10%. So it's very important to keep people in their homes, keep them the values and the affordable housing, but certainly the work that we do not only affects our community, it also affects the individuals that we serve. I mentioned safe and healthy housing for the individual. We base our work on science. We have partnered with the National Center for Healthy Housing. We have 7 principles that we look at, things like keep it safe, keep it dry, keep it clean, keep it well ventilated, keep it maintained, and contaminant free. To give you some examples of the work we do, keep it dry. We often are replacing roofs, especially here in the Northeast. Our roofs take a beating with the winters and the summers we have. We certainly do our share of roofs, but also just plumbing. You know, leaky plumbing can lead to mold and mildew in your home, which can affect your health as well. Give you an example of keep it safe. We have a Hyde Park resident, actually, who helps us on most of our projects, Feet Electric. We go into homes that were not built to utilize the electric that we demand of our homes today. And oftentimes, we're upgrading systems so that the homes can be safe for our homeowners. We're also looking for simple things that we find often are not in a home. Smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, or if they're there, they're on the table when we go to visit our elderly homeowner because they're afraid to get on a ladder, they're afraid to fall. So those are some things around safety that we look at. I'll just take a drink here.
Sure, go ahead.
So our existing programs are our rebuilding days, which are in April and October. Those are our big blitz that you probably have seen in the paper. Typically, we're investing about $20,000 to $25,000 in a home on our rebuilding day. We'll engage hundreds of volunteers on that single day and can really have an impact across the county. A couple years ago, we launched a handyman program for individuals that may not need that big impact. Maybe they haven't gotten to the point where the deferred maintenance has become so out of control, and so we're putting in a grab bar maybe or taking care of some handrails for that individual. Both of that program is year-round. Our rebuilding day, as I mentioned, is typically in April and October. We have started to expand those type of projects throughout the year because we have been able to secure additional grant funding, which will allow us to do more major system upgrades and really hardcore large-scaled accessibility modifications, like making a bathroom completely handicapped accessible, like project we did here in Hyde Park this April, as well as put in a handicapped ramp for him. So that funding coming from the state is allowing us to do some more of those large-scale projects that our volunteers typically could not take on. What I wanted to talk about today, in addition to our existing programs, and just remind people that if you know anyone who could benefit from our Rebuilding Day program, although our application is year-round, In order to be considered for our next rebuilding day, which is in April, individuals must apply by the end of September. Our application is on our website, rtduchess.org, or you can call our office at 454-7310 in order to see if you would qualify for our services, and we certainly will go through a list of qualifiers over the phone with an individual if they're not sure, and send you out an application. But don't delay. Oftentimes, individuals who are most likely to be served by us are least likely to apply. But we are here to serve individuals that want to stay in their home and want to live in a safe and healthy environment. So I encourage you to certainly apply. But I just wanted to mention a couple other programs that maybe you aren't aware of. This year, we launched our nonprofit repair program, which is part of our community revitalization efforts. We're really excited about this program. Oftentimes we find that our nonprofit partners are struggling just like our homeowners. They're deferring maintenance on their properties because they want to put all the programs in, all their resources into their programs. So we were able to accomplish two nonprofit projects this year, one at Family Services down in the city of Poughkeepsie, rebuilt a ramp for the individuals can get safely in and out of that property, and then also at Abilities First at one of their residential homes. And so, you know, there's been a lot of talk about that tonight, but ultimately that home is their home. And so we were happy to be able to paint it for them and get them involved. One thing that's going to become, I think, interest of a lot of your residents in Hyde Park is that historically we've been able to only serve mobile homes that is on property that is owned by the individuals. We have a funding source that is going to allow us to extend our services to mobile homes on property that's rented for wheelchair ramps. And so if you know of an individual, we think it's very important that somebody should be able to get in and out of their home safely. And so this funding source will allow us to do that. So if you know of somebody who could benefit from that, please do have them reach out to us. That is something that has changed in the last couple of months. And then we are looking to pilot two new programs this year, which we're very excited about. I mentioned earlier about safety and having functioning detectors in your home and how often we come across homes that do not have that. And so we are hoping to partner with our local Red Cross to provide a fire safety program where we would install smoke and carbon monoxide detectors in homes. And we're looking to do that in cluster-type projects so that we can utilize our volunteer base on a day and take care of multiple homes. So certainly if any of you are interested in your communities, we'd love to hear about that. We are piloting it, so we're just determining the qualifications for our program, but that will come out in the next several months. In addition to that, around safety and crime, actually, we are looking to do a lighted up program, which we would install solar exterior lights that are motion detectors detected on the exterior of a home, both for the safety of the homeowner so that when they're coming in and out of their homes, we know it's going to start getting dark here pretty early in the day, so that you can get in and out of your home safely and see where you're going, but also to deter crime. Certainly if somebody is luring around your home and the lights come on, they are less likely to stay there. These are two programs that have been in existence with some of our other affiliates. I mentioned earlier that we learned from our affiliates. These are two that have been very successful and have allowed our affiliates across the country to assist multiple homeowners. And so we're very excited about the potential to introduce that here in Dutchess County. Just one final thing, just to remind people again, September 30th is the deadline for applying for our National Rebuilding Day, which is in April. It's always the fourth Saturday in April, if any of you are interested in coming out and helping us on that day. But prior to that, we have our comedy night, which is a fundraiser. It's on September 22nd. It's our 10th annual. It's a ton of fun, as you probably could imagine, from a comedy night. It's at the Grandview at 6 o'clock. And the funds that we raise from there go into our programs and back into our homes. So we encourage you to support us in that way. And then right on the heels of that, we have our Fall Rebuilding Day, which is on Make a Difference Day, which is October 22nd. And we are going to do at least three homes on that day that we have planned now. We hope to pilot one of our new programs on that day as well. So we'll certainly need individuals to help us with that rollout. So I thank you again for having us.
Thank you
for having me here. I gave you all a checklist. This home safety checklist is available on our website. It's great for any homeowner to kind of take a look at making sure that your home is safe and healthy. I encourage you to look for it. And a number, all of these things on here are things that we address for our homeowners as well. So thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you, Christina. You guys are doing fabulous work. We've
thank
had
you.
The pleasure of yes. attending a couple of your events. Mm-hmm. And it's really heartwarming and inspiring to see the commitment of all your volunteers
you.
And the good work you're doing in Hyde Park. So thank you. The town of Hyde Park, we also have the application on our website. And if anyone needs any help filling it out, they could always stop by my office. We'd be very happy to help. So thank you great. Once again, and look forward to seeing you very soon on
yes.
the next Rebuilding Day.
Great.
Does anyone have any other questions?
No, thank you. Great work.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
And thanks for your patience. Okay, well, thank you all for your cogent comments. We have, as you know, just to review the things that we have done at the town board level, you know, we received the letter. It was the first time that we had heard about the project. We immediately did some research into some of the issues that residents brought up, had to explore our own zoning and to see if that was a relevant matter. We then forwarded the letter to the community, making sure that we sent it to all the residents. We organized the public meeting with Anderson and the officials from the Taconic DDRO to come explain their mission, their process, and the project. And at your request, we requested and were granted the date for the period to object to be extended, allowing time for additional research and exploration to be performed. We forwarded the list that Diane provided to us. Unfortunately, there did seem to be a message conveyed at that first meeting that an extensive list could be provided. But we were informed later after we did that, that was not the case. We've kept in communication with you via email. At the last meeting, people signed in, and hopefully everyone has received communications that we have sent. Our attorney, Warren, has spent many, many hours doing research. He's spoken to counsel from the Taconic DDRO, counsel from the Association of Towns, and the Committee for Open Government. And we've asked our engineer to research the traffic data. So I just wanted to kind of give you an update on the things that we have done. Obviously, this is a very passionate issue for you. It's very difficult for us because we've all taken an oath of office where we have pledged to uphold the state laws, the state of New York laws, and so that, you know, we have a real obligation to examine this issue from the legal perspective. So I think with that, I'll put this over to Warren, and you can kind of review some of the facts and the information that was provided and respond to various statements that were made and edify us with the actual law as it was written.
Well, the New York State Legislature passed the law, which is now Mental Hygiene Law, Section 4134, which was designed to provide local input on site selection process for local governments to maintain the nature and character of the community, and second, to discourage frivolous legal challenges and encourage a process of joint discussion and accommodation between the providers of care and services to the mentally disabled and representatives of the community rather than legal antagonism. The purpose of the law.
Yeah, you're speaking to the mic. Yeah.
Can I bring that closer?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah. the intent of the law, however, was to, and the effect of the law, was to limit the power of local legislation in the area of the siting of these facilities, while not precluding all local involvement in the community residential selection siting process. And as a result, these community residences are to be treated by local municipalities as single-family residents for purposes of the zoning. So if the town does not have the power through its zoning regulations to regulate these facilities in a manner different from other single-family residences.
And can I just interrupt? Is that
sure.
Okay? Sorry. You know, and that's just to speak to Dave Kutz's point, as well as the point of the engineer, that, okay, so zoning has designated this as a single-family use. That changes the complexion of how a town reviews that. And that is by design. That is how the state law was written. So that is why Mr. Kutz asked, you know, why is it that the town is not requiring this of Anderson? And that's the answer, because the state has basically taken that power away from us by designating this as a single-family home. Sorry, Warren.
That's okay. So as a result of this statute, the municipality, as Mr. Tuzinski indicated, has only three options when presented with a proposed siting of one of these facilities. It can approve the site recommended by the sponsoring agency. It can suggest one or more suitable sites within the jurisdiction to accommodate the facility, or it can object to the establishment of the site on the grounds that it would create such a concentration or residential care facilities in that area such that the nature and character of the area would be substantially altered. And that's a twofold test. There has to be a concentration of facilities in the proposed area, and the concentration must be such that the nature and character of the area would be substantially altered. The town can only do one of these things. If it approves the site, that's the end of the issue with regard to the town. If it suggests one or more suitable sites, it cannot object to the establishment of the site. If it objects to the establishment of the site, it cannot suggest one or more suitable sites. You don't have the option to do both. As I've explained before, the town is not required to hold a public hearing, but may, as the town has done in this situation, to get the input from the public. But unfortunately, you may, and Mr. Tuzinski, seem to give the impression to the public and to the board that the town has the right to reject this application. And it does not have the right to reject this application. It can only object to the establishment of the sites, but it has to be on the grounds of over-concentration, which will alter the character of the area, or to suggest one or more suitable sites. And unfortunately, the burden of proof that's been placed on municipalities where the municipality objects to the establishment of the site is very, very onerous. There has to be clear and convincing evidence. There has to be real probative proof of over-concentration and alteration of the character of the neighborhood. And as a result of that burden of proof, I have not been able to find a single case in which the court or a commissioner, well, it was one case where the commissioner disapproved of the site, but that was overturned by the court. But there has not been a single case where the site selection that's been proposed has been overturned by the court. That's how onerous the burden is. The issues of over-concentration, I'm sorry, I disagree with the presentation. The issue is not the over-concentration in the town or the number of facilities that the town has with regard to, as opposed to other neighboring municipalities. It's the issue is not whether there's a disproportionate number of facilities in Hyde Park, assuming for the sake of argument that 11 facilities in the town is a disproportionate number. That's not a relevant factor, and the town could not object to the siting on that basis. Unfortunately, there's no definition of over-concentration. It's not included in the statute. It's done on a case-by-case basis. And as I said before, I could not find a case where the courts have found an over-concentration, certainly not in a case where there's only really one facility in the neighborhood. There's a Court of Appeals case, matter of Jennings versus New York State Office of Mental Hygiene, in which there were five residential facilities within a 14-block area, and the court did not deem that, Court of Appeals did not deem that to be a over-concentration of facilities. That's how difficult the burden is in this area. The tax impact is totally irrelevant. Town cannot object to the siting of the facility on the basis that it will remove the facility from the tax rolls. It's not, has nothing to do with the fiscal impact, unfortunately, on the community. If the town is burdened with an excessive number of facilities, the town is burdened with that number of facilities, but we can't object to the siting of a particular facility on those grounds. There have been cases in which opponents to the to the project have relied on traffic concerns. There hasn't been a single case in which the traffic concerns have been held to be substantial enough to support a turning down of that facility by the commissioner and by the court. In addition, the traffic concerns have to relate to this particular facility. In other words, and this is the way I interpret the law, unless you can prove an over-concentration of facilities in that area, you can't get to the issue of the traffic concerns. Certainly, if you were going to appeal this, there would have to be more evidence of a traffic impact of this particular facility that would trigger a substantial increase in the traffic concerns over what presently exists. So you would need a traffic study in order to support that. As far as the declaration of covenants and restrictions, unfortunately, the Court of Appeals has decided that case also, cases Crane Neck Association versus New York City, Long Island County Services. And in that case, which went up to the Court of Appeals, the issue was whether restrictive covenants, almost identical to the ones in this community, could be used to thwart the siting of a facility in that neighborhood. And the court, interestingly, said under normal circumstances, that restrictive covenant would in fact be enforceable to prohibit this type of facility. But because of this provision of the mental hygiene law, that restrictive covenant cannot be used to thwart the intent of the mental hygiene law, and the court refused to allow a disapproval of the siting of the facility because of that restrictive covenant. It's not to say that the homeowners can't assert that in their own litigation against the Anderson School, but it's not going to be a relevant consideration. It's not an issue that the town board can take up and use to fight this facility. As far as alternative facilities, again, it's a tremendous burden that's placed upon the municipality. It's not just a matter of proposing another site. The site, the courts have said, really has to be shown to be superior to the sponsoring agency's proposal. Again, the courts have imposed an almost insurmountable burden on the municipality in even trying to assert alternative sites where the proponent of the site, in this case the Anderson School, disagrees with that. All Anderson School has to do, unfortunately, if we were to oppose an alternative site, is show a need for the site and to demonstrate that the site that's selected is not necessarily superior to the sponsoring agency's proposal. And I think it is unfortunate in this case that Anderson School has gone ahead and invested what they have in this property in terms of signing a contract, because I think it's they're going to fight very hard to oppose any alternative sites. It would have been better if they did not sign the contract, and it would be better for the municipality. I can just predict that any site, alternative site that's proposed by the municipality is going to be very, very much opposed to by Anderson School, and I suspect the commissioner will uphold the site. I'm sorry to be so negative, but unfortunately, that's what the law in this area is. I mean, the town is put in a no-win situation. We just don't have the tools available to us under the statute to in good faith put up either an opposition to the site or alternative sites. Now, this is a decision that the town board has to make. I'm not telling you one way or another. I'm just telling you what the law is and how difficult the law is to overcome. This does not mean that the town board cannot try to oppose this facility. Does not mean that you can't propose alternative sites. It just means that you're talking about, I think, fighting windmills in this case.
I do have a question, Warren. So my understanding is that I was not at the presentation by Anderson, but watched it on video. I was on vacation. That there was discussion that I lost my train of thought. I'm sorry.
That they would consider more than one.
That they would consider more than one, but when we applied, it was not the case. But if I recall correctly, it's the Taconic DDRO representative made it clear that he had screened their selection. Is that right, Emily and Ken, would you say?
They said it takes, when he was here, sometimes, you know, a year or two to find the right location.
And that it had gone through an approval process through their agency.
Correct.
And is it also true that the commissioner of that agency is the one who would hear any appeal? So that's, again, stipulated by the mental hygiene law that the same agency that screens it also hears the appeal. Is that right?
That's true, and it makes it much more difficult to sustain that appeal. Yeah, it was my understanding that Anderson School would consider a number of sites if the town gave them that list, but when that was proposed, there was a change in their position, and we were notified that the only thing they would consider would be a formal proposal of one or more alternative sites. So that's, but we did send that list on to Anderson, and that's the response that we got.
Right. So, no, clearly, I know many of you. I've been to Connolly Drive since it was built. Call many of you friends. It's a very difficult position that we find ourselves in. The last thing anyone in an elected position wants to do is to make 48 very involved residents angry. But as I mentioned, you know, we are very constrained by the mental hygiene law. You know, I often seek advice from other electeds, and in this instance, I talked with Senator Serino and her staff on several occasions to say, you know, what's your input here? What would you think, or what would you do? And you know, she and her staff basically said there's very little that can be done. That was the input that we received, and suggested that what we attempt to do is quiet the fears and let people know that, you know, in many instances, most instances, when these homes are actually effectuated, that the neighbors accept them and accept the people with disabilities that live in them. I've also...
That's not the question.
No.
That's not fair. That is not the question.
Excuse me, but I allowed you guys to speak. All right. Well, I'm also just going to say, you know, like I said, friends with many of you, we're in a difficult position. We are doing what we need to do for the town. You know, as I said, we took an oath of office to uphold the laws of the state of New York, one of which is that this law was designed to prevent frivolous actions. So You know, I'm not saying, I'm gathering the input that you've given. It was, as I said, obviously very impassioned, and there are a lot of details. So, you know, I'm reviewing them, but, you know, I'm just trying to keep, let everyone know what I'm thinking. I've also talked to our county executive right. on many occasions, who has provided good counsel in many, many circumstances. You know, I look to my peers for input. And as many of you know, one of his passions really is the Thinking Differently campaign. And, you know, asking people to think about people with disabilities in different ways, in new ways. And I hear, I hear what you're saying, that you don't, that it's not about that for you, but I'm just letting you know the people that I've consulted with and the things that I'm doing to try to come to a decision that's the right decision for our entire town. As Warren mentioned, the tax implications, I mean, really, you don't think that we're concerned about tax implications? You know, like, we're the people not all that different from you, but we're here because we want to make a difference, because we believe in Hyde Park, because we want to make Hyde Park a better place. That's why we're here. But we just walked into this job just as any of you might in the future. So tax implications, the last thing we want to see is additional properties off the tax rolls. The state has said that's not a factor we can consider. I mean, we would love to. We would love to say, you know, everybody, you no more tax, you know, no more properties off the tax rolls. But that is not a factor that we are allowed to consider. The traffic, you've made arguments about that, and very impassioned, and you know, obviously very upsetting for many of you to have witnessed or taken in victims from accidents. And you know, that's something that we will, I will continue to contemplate. But as Warren mentioned, it's not really something that is allowed to be considered either. And so, except in the circumstance of the concentration. So, I mean, those are my thoughts.
With the traffic.
I'd like to, yeah, Ken, this is Ken's ward, and, you know, I know he, like
we,
me,
we, you know,
we are, I mean, this is really dominated waking and sleeping thoughts for the last month. So
right, and I'm going to echo Supervisor. I mean, the last thing we want is upset residents. I mean, that's, you know, we're not here for that. We want to appease everyone, but yet we have four corners of this law that we have to live in and try to figure out, you know, what we can do and what we can't do. And like Supervisor, I stopped into Senator Serino's office. I spoke with her personally. At the Claudia Coppola event where we dedicated the portion of that road that was extremely dangerous. You know, I pulled aside our county executive for a good period of time to talk to him about this situation. I reached out to former Supervisor Todd Tancredi, who had this issue in his town. So I really have toiled and have really done a lot of work on this and have tossed and turned. I really struggle with the decision. You know, you spoke about the proposed sites and I struggle with this decision. You know, it's when I review all these other locations, I don't want to be disingenuous in this process. It's not up to me to choose where the residents live. You know, they deserve to live in a nice neighborhood just as well as you do, and they would be under the same circumstances that you're in. If there's an accident on a corner of 9G and Connolly and you can't get in or out, the residents would have that same issue. So there's what you guys live in now, it would be no different than the residents living up there if they moved in there today. So I took that into, you know, account. I spoke to the Statsburg Fire Department when Todd Bender was here with Underkill, where they live now, and asked, how many times has the fire department been called there? Zero. I went to our chief of police. How many times have there been disturbance in that home? Zero. So I know the issue is not that they're disabled and they have autism, but you know, but during this whole presentation we're talking about sidewalks. everything that you guys showed here didn't have sidewalks either, you know? And, you know, you said that it's a safe road. You walk your families, you ride your bikes, you push a stroller. That's where residents want to live as well, to do the same thing. They can't do that on Pine Woods. So, you know, it's not up to me as a resident to figure out what's a better home and what's not a better home. That's where Deconic came in, and they do their due diligence. So for me personally, and I am the ward member there for you guys, I live in the same ward. I pass Connolly Drive. Talking about Connolly Drive, you know, I know that, you know, talking to the Hyde Park Police Department, there's only been two accidents that's been reported over the past 3 or 4 years in the blotter. That's it. But I did speak to Senator Serino's office about trying to move the telephone back. I think you guys have made a great case for a DOT study. And possibly if Anderson moves forward with that Connolly Drive, that might push them even more to get a traffic study done. The reason why I say that is, you know what, they work closely with the state. Senator Serino is extremely close to the Anderson Center.
Well, I think that, just to that, pick that, up on that, that could happen. I mean, I think the town would like to be involved in a discussion, to initiate a discussion on the behalf of the Connolly Drive residents, you know, with DOT, Central Hudson, County DPW, the state DOT, you know, town police and highway personnel to get that study out, to see what can be done, what we can advocate for. You know, you mentioned the telephone pole and, you know, just reducing speed. I don't know, putting signs, whatever are the mechanisms that are available to make that a safer entrance and exit onto 9G. I mean, I think no matter what happens, you've made a very strong case that it's not, that you don't feel that safe.
But I can just, I just want to finish with this, is talking to Senator Sue Serino, talking to our county executive, talking to our former town supervisor, at the end they all say, you know what, Ken, it's tough, but there really isn't anything you can do, you know? And they have all been through this. And talking to our counsel, I mean, I'm not a lawyer. I can only go based upon the information that is given to me. But my stance as the Fourth Ward councilman, I don't see how we can oppose it, to be honest with you.
We've closed public comment.
Hold on. Yeah, yes, thanks. I'm sorry.
I'll send an email.
Thank you. Okay. You know, it's just, listen, it stinks. I get it. You know, I live in this community too. And, you know, how do I, you know, with 48 residents up there are going to be really mad at Ken Schneider, but there's nothing I can do about that.
It's after 9 and we still have...
Yeah, we have a lot of work to do. We are scheduling... We haven't made a decision. One of the resolutions on for Wednesdays, we're creating a special meeting. We are going to have a meeting on Wednesday, 5:30, with the resolution regarding this. So there would be public comment allowed at that time. Okay. Dave and Emily, do you have things that you would like to? Joe, sorry, Joe. Why don't we go down the line here? Do you have anything that you'd like to add?
What's the head?
I don't.
What's the head at this point?
You don't have to, Joe.
Well, I do want to say that this is a tough decision. I've lived in the Roosevelt Road area for 16 years. And when I moved in, I found out as I was going through the process that there was a home across the street for me. It was a children's home. And you know, I had all the questions you guys have. And, you know, but the neighbors said it really hasn't been an issue. And I will say for the 16 years I've been there, it has not been an issue. There is some cars going in and out, but it's, you know, it's normal traffic. So I just want to throw that out there that I've lived with it across the street from me in Roosevelt Road area, and it hasn't been an issue.
Thanks, Joe. Emily or Dave, do you have?
I just put my two cents in. I have a big family, and I have three nephews that are developmentally disabled. One lives in a home, Pleasant Valley, I think. I think it's on the border. It's a nice place, and he lives a normal life, participates in our family activities for the holidays, comes to Christmas or Thanksgiving dinner, and is very happy in the house. And he's probably near 60 years old now. No trouble with the home, no trouble with the neighbors. It's all I can go by. You know, autism is a disease that's really frightening to people when you don't understand it. I happen to have two nephews who have it, one severely and one not too bad. I know that.
I'm sorry. I'm just trying to tell you
where my heart is on this house.
Yeah.
All right,
yeah.
Then, if you don't want to hear what I have to say,
okay,
you want to shout me down.
Dave, let's just not no dialogue.
Well,
it's not.
I'm passionate on this.
But Dave, you know what? Actually, we all deserve to give the councilman respect for what he has to say. So please do finish.
Yeah. No, I'm quite passionate about this, and if there was a the yelling, the screaming, as one gentleman said at that meeting, somebody defecated on the lawn, you know, that would really be upsetting. It doesn't seem to be what they're proposing for this house, the five individuals. However, Anderson Center was not forthcoming with all the facts. They made it look like, if you want to give us 40 homes, we'll look at everyone. You know, so there was mixed messages there, and I understand your concern. But it seems to me, with the advice of council, once they've decided on this and the commissioner says okay, there's not too much we can do. The traffic has always been bad there since they put that in. I've been going there. You know, you're supposed to slow down to 45, nobody does. And you, when you see a clearing, you punch it and you try and get out on 9G. And I definitely think a study's done just for, you know, from what you've brought up. But that's all I have to say. And I appreciate your comments and the community's effort of coming together on something like this. It's really great to see.
Emily?
Yeah, I, again, just wanted to compliment all of you on your care for your community and the research you've put into this. You've given us a lot to think about. You know, I've spent hours thinking about, many hours thinking about this, you know, over the past month. It's really, it's very difficult to be in the position that we're in, because obviously, you know, we want to please all of you. So the best we can do is act in good faith and act professionally, and that's what we're trying to do. You know, I've read over all the comments that were submitted. I've reviewed all the suggested locations. I've visited Connolly Drive, driven around. I've spoken with the town attorney several times to try to understand the law better, because it really, it's somewhat misleading. Excuse me. It makes it seem as if we have a lot of control, yeah. That once you dig into the decisions that the courts have made, it just wouldn't go anywhere if we try to challenge it. So we're really kind of boxed into a corner. You know, we are responsible for the town's finances, and putting a lot of resources into lodging an objection and pursuing an appeal, knowing that it's not going to go anywhere, is really not, in my opinion, a wise use of the town's resources. And as far as choosing another location, I mean, I know from the presentation that the Anderson Center and the DDRO have reviewed all the available homes and chosen the one they feel is best. So I just am fairly sure that if we were to suggest an alternative, they would surely have a reason that it's not as good as the one they already chose. So I'm not sure that would really go anywhere. As far as the traffic issue, I mean, you bring up a really important point, and that intersection is the borderline between wards 1 and 4. North Cross Road is ward 1, and I would be more than happy to reach out to the state or the county. I know the county transportation council that I participate in does do traffic studies when they relate to county roads, and I would be happy to reach out to them and see if we can't get something together, because I know that would really affect all of your quality of life if we could improve that intersection in some way. So that is something that I would like to follow up on, and yeah, that's all I've got for now. Thanks.
Thank you, Emily. Okay, so heard from everyone. We're I suggest that we all explore this more thoroughly, including the data, the lots of data and information you've provided, and we will schedule a vote for this coming Wednesday at 5:30. So I have someone who's asking. I'm sorry, but we've.
No, I got a question for Connolly. I really appreciate because I have something I've said. My name is Janet Stewart. I live at 162 Cranbrook Drive in Hyde Park. Who is Ed?
Ed,
right? I was just concerned about the swimming. The seniors don't have.
Oh, okay. Wait. We're done. That's something. Have a seat.
Okay, that's
we're done. Yeah, that's not it. Okay. Another issue.
Okay.
So I really am very respectful of all the information you've gathered, your passion, and your position. I know that you probably don't feel the same way about us, but I can just tell you that. It matters to us. We are committed to doing what is the best thing for the entire town, considering all the factors. So there will be a vote on this coming Wednesday. Unfortunately, Councilman Schneider will not be here because he's going to be in Wisconsin working. So,
but I do know the issue is safety and traffic at that intersection. We'll work on that. And if we get that resolved between the county and the state and the town, then it would seem like a lot of these issues would kind of go away. So,
okay. So moving on,
should we just take a quick break if people wanted to?
Yeah.
I mean, I just,
yeah.
So that there's not.
Well, I was going to suggest, I mean, it's been a long night already. Would you like to defer the, revitalizing the Hyde Park Town Center till next time?
That's fine.
Yes.
I think
yeah.
So, because yeah. We'd like people to see that, and I'm sure they, and so let's
I'll make a motion to do that.
To defer that.
I'll make a motion.
And do you want to defer the CDBG, or we should just at least get that started?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're going to defer that one as well?
Okay, no, we're going to have a motion to defer revitalizing Hyde Park Town Center.
I'll make that
and to And a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And that we'll put on September 26th meeting. And we will, though, have the CDBG grant discussion shortly. But I will, woman who just, resident who just came in, would like to comment on some other topic of town business. So I will allow her to do so now.
Should we just take a break while they?
Yeah, let's yeah. Take, yeah, take a break.
I think she's coming. Aileen, she'll come up. Right.
Oh, okay.
Me all by myself?
Well, oh, yeah.
Yes, just give us a minute. Let's let everybody clear out, and then because we do want to hear what you have to say.
This is my first time, so I don't know.
Well, welcome.
Interesting.
Have you been watching at home?
I will not. I heard that. I've read it. But I spoke to you.
About?
The summer.
Okay.
I called you about swimming. Don't worry, Alan.
Okay. Oh, okay. Miss, our town clerk has just said she thinks there's information on the swimming on the table back here.
Okay, I get it.
If you want to.
I will, but there's something else too.
Oh, okay. All right.
Let's get her going.
Yeah. Okay.
All righty. So,
I'll be short, because I know you guys are kind of probably.
Okay, can I have a motion to open public comment on resolutions?
Yes.
And second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Just if you wouldn't mind stating your name and your address. Yeah, just use this because they want to hear you at home.
Okay. My name is Janet Stewart. I live at 162 Pinebrook Drive in Hyde Park. I'm a retired culinary teacher, and I took swimming lessons this summer. And I found it was fantastic, especially for me. I'm a 72-year-old woman. I don't look 72, but I am 72, and I'm a retired teacher. And a lot of seniors where I live really don't swim in the wintertime. So I was concerned about that, and I called Ed, yes, and I spoke to you, and you got back to me, and I was so happy about that. Lots of seniors in my neighborhood, I have already caucused for them to swim, hopefully, that we could get something going in Hyde Park for the seniors. A lot of seniors just stay home and just maybe read a book, watch television. They need to get out there and do some exercises. And that's my concern. I have a passion about that.
That's great.
The application's right on the table out there.
Okay.
CIA pool, which starts in October.
Great, because, yes, I did some teaching too at the CIA very briefly. Okay. So I'm really, you know, maybe with them. I really would appreciate that.
If you can involve additional residents, that's beneficial for the program.
Definitely. I will. Absolutely. I definitely will. I already spoke to them.
A handful of them home.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
All right.
So where do I go from here? Do I just fill out the applications and bring them back to you?
I would take it with you. There's probably additional information on the website.
Okay.
Okay? Mm-hmm. And then if you could just follow what it says there, it probably is returned to the recreation office. Yep.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate
it. Nice seeing you.
Yep. Thank you.
Bye-bye
now. Okay. So we did have another two items on the agenda that were Emily's purview, and we're cutting out the revitalizing Hyde Park Town Center update on the NYSERDA grant. We'll put that on next week. But we do have a discussion on this community development block grant process, and we kind of want to bring the board up to speed, let you know what we're thinking about this year for those projects. So Emily, want to go?
I was just wondering, Ted, would you mind pulling that door closed?
Yeah,
just
actually all of them.
Thank you. So as you know, every year we have an opportunity to apply for a community development block grant through Dutchess County. And this year, the applications are due October 21st. There's a process that we need to go through with a public hearing, so we kind of need to hone in on a project. Probably by the next meeting, we should try to focus in on a project. I think all the board members received the request for proposals that show the categories that are eligible and also the areas of town that are considered low to moderate income. Supervisor Rohr and I have spent some time this year going over the categories that we haven't really thought about in the past. It seems like pretty much what people do with these grants are sidewalks and pedestrian improvements or park improvements. But there are actually a number of other categories. And the one that we wanted to bring up tonight to the board's attention and anyone watching at home is the economic development category. There's a category for economic development that results in job creation in traditional centers and low and moderate income communities. And it's kind of a complicated application. There are different, you have to kind of, it's almost a Chinese menu. You have to pick one from, you have to qualify in each category. So that's the county priority that we would be looking within. And then you also have to fit within the qualifications under HUD. This is a federal HUD program for economic development. But to kind of cut to the chase, if there were a business that were either building or expanding in Hyde Park and needed funds for exterior improvements to a building in order to create a new business or expand a business, they might be eligible to apply through the town for these CDBG funds. And you know, we would love to see more businesses come to Hyde Park, expand in Hyde Park. The qualification would be, this is one of the other categories that you have to meet, the qualification would be that they would have to create jobs for low to moderate income people. And I think the ratio, correct me if I'm wrong, is supposed to be $10,000 per job. So if you wanted $150,000, you'd have to create 15 jobs, but it could be some lesser amount, $50,000 for five jobs. So I just wanted to kind of put the word out to the board and anyone who's watching at home, if they have such a project that they'd like the town board to consider, to contact us. And we really, this is not a category that is popularly used, so we're kind of figuring out the qualifications as we go along. But my understanding is that, like I said, if it's an improvement to the exterior of a building that is needed to either create or expand a business that would create jobs in the community, it may be eligible.
And just to clarify the job creation, so it is 10,000 per job created, and half of the jobs created have to be for low to moderate income.
Yeah,
people.
And moderate is not that low.
No, and so
yeah.
I mean, so even restaurants or, you know, things that employ low to moderate income people could really qualify. So I'm very excited about this. I think it's really where we need to go. You know, we've put a lot of applications in for sidewalks, and that's something that we've spent a lot of time developing and doing. And but yet, you know, we know that really what needs to be improved are our buildings and our businesses. So if we can direct some community development block grant monies that way, that could be fantastic. So you, as board members, if you're driving around and you think of something or talking with someone, I know there's a chamber after hours, I think, tomorrow. You know, we could just really kind of brainstorm that. And one project that's very exciting that was just submitted is for a bed and breakfast in the property adjoining Hyde Park Elementary. Mm-hmm. So that would be fantastic. And so, you know, I'm interested in exploring whether that might qualify. But definitely other properties that would benefit by this infusion of cash, we would love to come up with something that will rate well.
And just to clarify, normally we're looking for projects that are within one of the census tracts that's considered low to moderate income. But I clarified this with the program director. If you're creating jobs for low to moderate income people, that does not apply.
Okay.
Because the benefit is to those people who are employed.
Right.
It doesn't have to be in the exact correct census tract. And in fact, it's so not used that they kind of forgot to even put that option on the RFP.
Well,
but we did clarify that that is an option. So,
yeah. I think we will be talking with Ann Saylor as we progress on this, the program director. So we wanted to get that out there. And at our next meeting, we'll be fine-tuning this. And as Emily said, starting the public process on it.
When does that application have to be in?
It has to be in October 21st. So we tentatively have kind of, Pete always backs out the schedule. He says we should have the public hearing on October 3rd so that we can have a resolution on the October 17th meeting. So we kind of need to, at the next meeting, have a kind of hone in on a project and set the public hearing so that we can get all these steps done on time. Did anybody else have any ideas for CDBG this year?
I think that sounds wonderful. I mean, it's a different way of attacking it, and I think it sounds wonderful. So, I mean,
I never heard of that. I never thought. I was thinking of my historic bridge on South Drive that needs.
I just submitted an application for that.
Oh,
to Bridge New York, which is a program that is unveiled this year, first program along with Pave New York, where the town got an extra $43,000. They've dedicated I don't know how many millions of dollars at the state for this Bridge New York program. So we did just submit an application for the South Drive Bridge.
All right.
So, I spoke with Dee Dee Barrett, our assemblywoman, and you know, gave some input and asked her if she could shepherd that for us.
You could definitely use another bridge closure.
Hey,
seems like no matter where you go.
Well, yeah. But then when they're closed and they reopen, everybody is so happy.
Oh, that's
yeah. That's my goal.
I like it.
It isn't fixed, they won't be.
Okay, so are we ready to go on the resolutions?
Yes.
Thank God.
Yeah, I think so. All right. Resolution 912-1 of 2016, resolution authorizing the town supervisor to execute an intermunicipal agreement with the Hyde Park Central School District, nunc pro tunc.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 812-2 of 2016, resolution accepting a proposed local law to override the tax levy limit for fiscal year 2017 pursuant to general municipal law Section 3C for commencement of local law adoption process.
Okay, so the tax cap this year is at, I think, 0.56%. So every year we pass this as a precaution. Three out of the last 4 years, we haven't needed to use it, but it is advisable for all municipalities to pass this in case we need to exceed the tax cap. And so
we're
that's why we have
best.
It. We're gonna do our best.
Struggle.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 912-3 of 2016, Resolution authorizing Kathleen Moss, zoning administrator, to attend the 16th annual Southeast New York State Stormwater Conference and Trade Show.
And she's in the audience. She wants to see how we vote. Here we go.
Well, that sounds very exciting.
I'll second.
About this.
I'll second.
It's very wild.
Yeah. It's a big party. We know.
It's a vegan, you know. Whoa.
It's good food.
Okay. And Emily seconded, and all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
It's only because we are strong arm here in New York. Yeah. There. Resolution 912-4, 2016. Resolution authorizing the town supervisor to submit an application for the State and Municipal Facilities Program, the SAM, funding for improvements to the highway facilities project.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Did we go over what this is for? This is following up on the presentation we had earlier.
With the roof and the salt shed.
Yeah. And it looks like we are going to be awarded some money, so we are tracking the paperwork down.
Good.
Resolution 912-5 of 2016, appointment of planning board secretary.
Second. Well, that's why she's here. Now we know. Mm. So yes, Cynthia Palestina Whitman is being appointed. And do we have a second?
Yep.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we're so happy. I know Tad is very happy and want to thank Ann so much for her hard work. She's really pitched in. We had someone retire who had been on disability before that, so it's been quite a long time. So thank you for your hard work, and Anne especially. And looking forward to Cynthia's arrival tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Woo-hoo. Great.
I think it's Dave.
It's Dave.
Oh, is that one? Resolution 912-6 of 2016. Resolution setting special town board meetings for the purpose of the 2017 budget.
Should have been.
Second.
Which one do you
So this is for the 2017.
Oh, 912.
Yeah, we're having additional meetings. So please, everyone, mark your calendars right now.
Yes.
Okay. For budget discussions, October 12th, October 24th, November 7th.
Did we vote on that?
Did we vote?
No, we didn't.
Oh, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Resolution 912-7 of 2016. Resolution setting a special town board meeting for the proposed Anderson Center group home at 55 Connolly Drive.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
And I just want, for the record, I will not be here this Wednesday. But as I stated earlier, I know my vote, since I won't be here, but for the record that we don't oppose the home.
Okay.
That'd be my vote.
Okay, thanks, Ken.
I'm sorry, what was it?
I will not be here Wednesday. So if I was here, my vote would be I would not oppose the home.
Well, thanks, Ken.
I just wanted that for a record.
Thanks, Ken.
Okay. Don't want to dodge that one.
I don't know. I was thinking of going to Wisconsin with
you. It was a good way to go. But, you know, for the record, I wanted to, you know, I came into this office with my head high. I'm going to walk out the same way.
You bet.
That's right.
So
you bet.
We're not here to make all easy decisions all the time. It's
very, very true. And
so we'll move on.
Yep.
Resolution 912-8 of 2016, a resolution rejecting all bids for the Dinsmore Park basketball court project.
Okay, so I think I should just review this with everyone. We had a workshop on this, I believe, last fall, early spring, mm-hmm. On the an improvement to the Dinsmore Park basketball court, which we're all very excited about. We think it's a good project, and we'd love to see improvements there. The bids came back, however, twice what was projected. The original cost that was projected by our engineer was around $62,000, I believe. Mm. No, I think it was around $45,000.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, someone wrote.
And that included fencing.
Yeah, and that included, and in fact, the bridges came in, the bids came in at 86.4 as the low bid to 124.5 as the high bid without a fence.
Yeah.
So, you know, we had passed by resolution on April 1st to go forward with that based on that estimate of
$45,000. Just to clarify, the letter says that the estimate was 62. I think that included the fencing.
Okay.
I think it was 45.
Without it.
Is that right?
No. 45 was with the fencing.
That was what
that was their estimate.
That was the estimate. Yeah.
That was what they thought it was going to come in at.
Yeah.
Right. And in fact, it came in 86.
That's not what Kathleen's letter says.
No.
That's in here.
Oh, really?
No.
It's sort of irrelevant.
Yeah, so. But the chart that she provided does show 46 as the estimate. But in any case, it's not the determining factor. The determining factor is that the bids came in much higher than was the projected cost.
Correct.
So what I think we need to do is reject the bids because they also had put bonds up in order to do that, and regroup make sure that the board is comfortable spending that amount. My recommendation is that any proposal include a fence, because I think that's an important part of the project. If you're going to be investing, you know, upwards of $60,000 into a surface, I think that surface should be protected from vehicles or and vandalism. And I'm hoping that we can, I'm going to be meeting with a few of the rec commissioners and then having an additional workshop where we can kind of toss around the ideas of possibly a different surface.
It has to be a different surface.
You feel that way too, Ken?
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah.
And you and I have spoken about this.
Yep.
And, you know, we have a trust fund for a rec fund for
our
parks.
I just want to say what that in the rec trust fund right now is $424,000. And there's some items that are earmarked for this year that
right.
have not been paid out of that.
Right.
So that's what's in there, about $425,000.
Right. And I don't have an issue spending money on the parks. That's what it's there for.
Right.
As I said to you previously, there's nothing worse than an organization, you know, collecting monies and then just having it sit in a bank. You know, we should be improving our parks. And I think the Statsburg location is a perfect example of us needing to improve a park. I'm just not satisfied with that sport court. It's going to be high maintenance. It's going to break. I think we just need to have a traditional basketball court.
A very nice basketball
court. And be a really nice basketball
great, you know,
court.
Whatever else
right.
that is
right.
High end.
And I'm excited that we're doing something in that Statsburg mm-hmm. location, because, I mean, that's an area that really needs it. So I'm excited to see,
okay.
you know, the project kind of move forward, but just in a different
okay, so
different
that's the plan. I'm going to be meeting with them in early October, Joe
Perfect.
And I, and then we'll workshop at
Perfect.
Some point after that with a couple of rec commissioners.
Perfect. So we need to vote on that.
Okay, so
second.
You have a second, and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Emily, you don't mind I read this next one, do you? Since it's my ward.
Yeah.
It's been a long time coming.
Yeah.
Tad's, that's why Tad's here.
Oh.
Resolution
now
9.
Now we keep thinking we.
Yeah.
And we always wonder, what does Tad do?
Yeah, we're taking notes.
Resolution 912-9 of 2016. Resolution authorizing the commencement of legal action with regard to town code and property maintenance violations at the property known as 609 Salt Point Turnpike in the town of Hyde Park, which is probably one of the most egregious properties in Hyde Park. So I am ecstatic, and hopefully the whole town board will vote yes on this.
Second.
Warren, did you want to just review it briefly? I mean, it doesn't need a long.
Yeah, this is a troublesome piece of property. It's been reported to us by the zoning enforcement officer and building inspector that there exist several violations of the town code with regard to improper storage of garbage and rubbish, keeping of unregistered and derelict automobiles and other vehicles, notices of violation have been served but not responded to by the property owner. The town, this resolution is required by section 65 of the town law. Before we take any legal action, what legal action we take will be determined by me as attorney to the town in consultation with the town board and the zoning enforcement officer, but it could take the form of filing something in justice court. It could take the form of an injunction action in Supreme Court. But whatever we decide, it's now authorized by this
Perfect.
Resolution.
Okay. Perfect. And all in favor?
Aye.
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 Resolution 9-12-10 of 2016, resolution approving budget revisions to the Town of Hyde Park for the period of August 2016, budget revisions number 2016-08.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Resolution 9-12-11 of 2016, resolution for Hyde Park opposition to proposed anchorages of commercial vessels along the Hudson River.
Okay. Yeah, Emily has been involved in the development of the position.
So right now, there are allowed anchorages for barges and tugboats up to Yonkers. And then the only other one between Yonkers and Albany is right here at Hyde Park.
Right here.
And the Coast Guard has just put out a proposal to add 10 more anchorages between Yonkers and Kingston. And it's caused a lot of concern, not only among municipalities and communities, people who are concerned about the view of the river, but also there's concern among environmental organizations about the impacts to sturgeon. And there's concern among everyone who drinks the Hudson River water that if there were to be an accident, it could really endanger our water. And in case I didn't mention, the reason that this proposal has come forward is because of the planned increase in the transport of crude oil up and down the Hudson River. So right now, it's at the very preliminary stages, and the Coast Guard is accepting comments on the proposal before they develop an actual proposal for where the locations would be. And so this resolution that Supervisor Rohr prepared basically says that we are concerned about the addition of more anchorages, and we're asking that while the Coast Guard is considering this, that they reconsider the location in Hyde Park and look for the best locations throughout the area, potentially removing the one at Hyde Park.
Great, thank you. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Resolution 9-12-12 of 2016, resolution accepting office supply donations from Honorable Joseph Petito to the Town of Hyde Park Justice Court.
Second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. May I have a motion to adjourn? Did you want to go into executive session on something? No. Okay. I thought you had mentioned that a while ago.
A motion to adjourn?
Yes.
Second.
I don't remember.
Aye.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.